Mark Cuban is one of the wealthiest people in America, with an estimated net worth of $4.3 billion. But getting there wasn't easy. He spent his early 20s sharing a three-bedroom apartment with five other guys. In this video, I'm gonna break down how Mark went from broke to billionaire by the age of 41. Let's dive in. Mark Cuban was born on July 31st, 1958 in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and grew up in a working-class family, just like a lot of us. While his father spent nearly half a decade working as an automobile upholsterer, some would say the roots of his entrepreneurial genes were seeded from his grandfather, who immigrated from Russia, and fed his family by selling merchandise out of his truck. Mark Cuban actually started hustling at a very young age. At 9 years old, he was buying baseball cards, bundling the Pittsburgh Pirates players together, and reselling them on the playground at a premium. At age 12, he sold garbage bags door to door, and by the age of 15, he was peddling stamps. Cuban points to this particular hustle as a teaching him as much about business as any class he's ever taken. Through collecting stamps, he was able to learn about the laws of supply, demand, pricing, when to buy, sell, and hold an asset. That stamp money he made eventually helped pay for college at the University of Indiana, where his side hustles really started taking off. At college, Mark would teach sorority girls how to disco for $25 an hour. His next big step up was opening a bar called Motley's. This bar became the go-to spot in Bloomington, but was ultimately shut down after word got out that an underage girl had won a wet t-shirt contest. Unfazed by the shutdown, Cuban took these business lessons from Motley's into his next venture.
Business model he used in Motley's is very close to the same business models he used in his next two or three businesses. He always would have 51% of it, even though he didn't put up any of his own money, but no one really complained because he was the one that built up business.
Major takeaways that we can learn from this period of his life, that he spent a decade building up experience as an operator, salesman, marketer, before he even really started a first real business. And because of that, he was able to negotiate majority ownership in ventures like Motley's without having to put up any of his own money. So something to think about for yourself, especially if you're young, even if you're really, really old, is take action now. So yes, you can watch a lot of these videos, you can buy more books and courses, you can look for other software tools. But what Mark did is that he put in the time to try a lot of businesses out, and eventually that built up skills for him to be successful at larger companies. Hello friend, I'd love to help you become just like Mark Cuban. I have started multiple 7- and 8-figure companies. I was number 30 at Facebook, and I do live office hours every single Friday where I answer your questions to help you on your business journey. This month as well, I'm giving away a company to one of the subscribers, so make sure you hit the notification bell and the subscribe button, not in that order, so you don't miss out. First note, after college, Mark drove all the way to Dallas in a beat-up Fiat, beep beep, with $60 in his pocket when he moved into a three-bedroom apartment with five other guys and eventually landed a job at one of the first PC software retailers, Your Business Software. His role was to open the store, sweep the floors, and sell software. The issue, Mark didn't know anything about software. Every night, he actually brought home a different software manual and read it no matter how late it was.
And I would tell myself, there's the people who wrote the software, and then there's everybody else. And so if I can out-hustle everybody else, know how to make it work better than anybody, I can get paid. So I would take the PCs back and I would stay up all night just teaching myself. I would take the manuals, like software manuals, and read them. Very quickly, I learned that by putting in that extra time, I knew stuff that people who went to college for this stuff and had advanced degrees in it didn't know, because they only knew what they were taught in school and they weren't doing the work to keep up.
9 months into that job, Mark had become the top salesman, but was fired for disobeying his boss.
I go to my boss and I'm like, look, I want to close this deal. And he's like, no, you got to be there to open up the store. Made the executive decision to go pick up the check, thinking when I bring him a $15,000 check, $1,500 of which is going to be mine, life is good, right? Fired me on the spot.
Damn. So this was actually the third straight time he'd been fired, at which point Mark realized maybe he shouldn't work for other people. So with the support from several customers, he actually started his own business called Micro Solutions, a computer consulting service. Mark actually grew the company to over $30 million in revenue, and in 1990, at the age of only 32, he sold the company to CompuServe and pocketed a cool $2 million from the deal. Some key takeaways from this period of his life is that Mark attributes a lot of his early success to the power of being broke. Lived with five guys in a three-bedroom apartment, slept on couches, and didn't take a vacation for 7 years. Because he was already living a low-cost lifestyle, he didn't have anything to lose. So for me, I was fired by Facebook. I was fired at Mint.com. I had my company banned by Facebook later. Yeah, I had a chip on my shoulder. I think the same thing was happening with Mark, was he had nothing to lose and he wanted to prove himself. So think about how you can put yourself in that position. Next up is read the frickin' manual. As he writes in his blog, a guy with a little computer background can compete with far more experienced guys just because I put in the time to learn all I could. Most people won't put in the time to get a knowledge advantage. Will you? By the way, you sexy viewers, thank you for watching this. This is a new series we're trying about the rise of very successful people. Let me know who you want us to do videos on and what you think of this video in the comments below. First billion, that's so crazy to actually talk about. After Cuban sold Micro Solutions, Mark started trading tech stocks and he did so well that he turned it into a hedge fund and almost sold that too. And it turns out in 1995, Mark and his co-founder, Bill Wagner, launched AudioNet, one of the first online streaming services, which they later renamed Broadcast.com. In 1998, at the peak of the internet boom, Mark took Broadcast.com public and the stock price soared 250% of the first trading day, setting a new record for the highest run-up of a newly issued IPO. Less than 9 months after the IPO, Yahoo bought the company for $5.7 billion. Smart enough, Cuban sold most of his Yahoo stock that same year, netting over $1 billion himself. The key here is that Cuban went to his broker and issued a caller.
And I had to wait 6 months, and that was a nerve-wracking 6 months, but I sold what's called calls on Yahoo, which gave somebody else the right to buy it at a higher price. And I used that money to buy something called puts, which meant if the stock dropped below a certain point, I was able to sell that stock at the value of the put. When the internet stock market bubble burst, that saved me.
Well, that last part's actually really interesting. So he did puts and calls, but that cost him money, so he didn't make as much as he could. But he also protected himself so he didn't lose as much as everybody else did. I think one of the most important things right with this moment is how much is enough, and something I think about all the time. In 2002, just 3 years after this purchase, Yahoo shut down most of its broadcast services, and this has since been called one of the worst internet acquisitions of all time. Key takeaway here is know how much is enough and limit your downside. Yahoo was one of the most valuable companies in the world and was seemingly too big to fail. So when Mark started selling his Yahoo stock options, he was actually widely criticized. He wasn't being greedy. He knew how much was enough and made some smart decisions to cash out right before Yahoo started to tank. Another thing is that luck is when opportunity meets preparation. I hate these kind of cliche lines, but a lot of people chalk up Mark's success to be one of the lucky few to come out of the top from the dot-com bubble. And while that might be true, he put himself in that position to be lucky through a lot of years of hard work. By the way, if you like Mark Cuban and this video, can you take your finger right here and hit that like button for us? Billionaire status. So after reaching Billy status, Cubes, as we're now gonna call him, started living his best life. He bought a 24,000 square foot mansion, a $40 million jet, and the Dallas Mavericks for a cool $285 million. But this is the fascinating part. That was the largest price ever paid for a sports team at the time. We actually did a video, part one of the Mark Cuban series, where we do a deep dive on how he makes over $200 million a year just from the Mavs and $1 billion a year from all of his other businesses I'm about to cover. So make sure to check out that video afterwards. After purchasing the Mavs in 2000, Mark's superstardom started to climb. He became known as the brash billionaire who regularly made headlines for berating referees. He even once told a referee that he couldn't manage a Dairy Queen. And then Mark went to work at the Dairy Queen as a PR stunt. In his first season as the owner of the Mavs, Cuban was actually fined over $500,000. But that fiery passion turned the franchise around from one of the worst teams in the league to one of the most successful sports franchises in the world. In the 20 seasons that Cubes own the Mavericks, they've only had 3 losing seasons, and the team is now valued at over $2.4 billion, an 8x return off his initial price. In addition to making waves on the court, Mark has also dove headfirst into several notable ventures like HDNet and purchasing Magnolia Pictures and Landmark Theaters, effectively building one of the first vertically integrated media companies of its kind. You'll also find Mark regularly making cameos on WWE, Dancing with the Stars, and Entourage, all the while making a number of startup investments in companies ranging from social software to high-tech toilet seats. One of Mark's investments ended him in hot water with the SEC. In 2008, he was accused of insider trading after a series of suspect events saved him from a $750,000 loss. Cuban, though, didn't hold back in contending the allegations, claiming the investigation was a product of gross abuse of prosecutorial discretion. Ultimately, the court ruled in Cuban's favor, and the case was dismissed. 2011 proved to be a huge year for Mark. Not only did his beloved Mavs win their first NBA title, he also joined a little up-and-coming TV show called Shark Tank. And beyond Mark's Shark Tank fame, he's also a best-selling author and has been the executive producer on movies that have been nominated for 7 Academy Awards. He's also founded the Mark Cuban Foundation, a nonprofit that leads programs, including the AI Bootcamps Initiative, which hosts free introduction to AI bootcamps for low-income high schoolers, and the Fallen Patriot Fund, that is awesome, supports families of US military personnel killed or injured during the Iraq War. At the age of 61, Mark has still the same bold personality and insatiable hunger for knowledge that got him to where he is today. Love him or hate him, Mark Cuban knows how to win. It's easy to point to Mark's journey as a series of successes, but there were so many failures along the way. His bar, Motley's, was shut down, he moved to Dallas with only $60 to his name, he was fired from countless jobs over his career, and after getting fired from Your Business Software, he tried launching powdered milk product. That flopped. HDNet floundered as it only reached 350,000 homes in its first year. His TV show, The Benefactor, was canceled before the first season. You get my point. But as Cubes highlights in his book, it doesn't matter how many times you almost get it right, No one's going to care or know about your failures, and neither should you. So whenever he fails at something, he tells himself two things. One, what can I learn? Damn, that's a great question. What can I learn? And two, whose ass am I going to kick to get back in the win column? Let's go. Let's throw that W up there. To this day, Mark is still a voracious learner and spends 4 to 5 hours a day reading. Mark attributes his ability to sell as his best asset. If your sales skills aren't good, go and sell something or read a lot of books on how to sell better. Mark thinks that no matter what in life, he'd always be able to find a job at any company he ever started would always have a chance of survival because of his selling abilities. So Noah's take, copy the habits of billionaires. They are leaving breadcrumbs of their success along the way. What can we see that Bill Gates, Zuckerberg, Bezos, Cuban, Buffett have all done? They're all readers. They've tried a lot of things out and they keep going for long periods of time. So copy the habits of billionaires. If you've liked this video, make sure to check out this video where I break down exactly how Mark makes over $1 billion a year from his businesses. I'll see you out there and I love you. Pew, pew. I do like the pew, pew. I don't know if it's like, let me see, it's like,